to be responsive to your question, I don't know whether I could put a name on it. Don was very eloquent. And I was thinking about, I thought about Don a long time over these years. And one of the things that I want to tell you is he had something to lose. And he did lose it. He lost that powerful job. And I've always respected him for it because that took character. And Don has character. And I think he did. I think he did work changes. I think character, however, doesn't change history in all instances. And seeing Don's edit of the Fred Hampton section right there makes me so sure that 44 years ago, I made the absolute best decision of my media life to say, Don, if you try to put that footage of the funeral on our tape of Fred Hampton, I will pull out every plug in this control room, and those three suits in the other room, I don't know what we called them, we didn't call them suits then, they had a name, but the three really biggest people at CBS television, it won't have anything to see. And Don acquiesced because he didn't have a choice. I didn't leave him a choice. I was threatening to sabotage his show, which always struck me as a highly irresponsible thing to do in some ways. Damn, I'm glad I did it. I'm not trying to gainsay Don, because I think what he did was really, really important, in not only in our lives, but I think it is a moment, a seminal moment in video or television history. I don't know how it's going to be interpreted. And maybe some of you will look at the show side by side. Our show wasn't good. Don's right. They were never going to touch that. Don, you know, started working in the fall of 1969 with Don. He had met David and Mary Curtis, and he can tell you, and others can tell you the specifics of that. But we had shot some footage for him. And then Don had a friend, and he talked to you. You mentioned the technology. And you had a friend, was it Bob Zagorin? Is that his name? Bob Zagorin. He was very high up in engineering at CBS, I believe. He's a really nice man. And Don got him in touch with us because they decided we needed more equipment. Now, we had this. We had a port-a-pack. It was a camera. And it's about the size of a laptop for the recorder, the port-a-pack. And so we said, more equipment? What do you need? Well, come and meet us at the Cow Barn. What's called, right? The Cow Barn? It was the CBS Broadcast Center. And he said, but you can't tell anybody you're going there. You can't tell them why you're there. We're going to look at more equipment. And so we went to look at more equipment. It was called the Cow Barn. This is a broadcast center in the west side here in Manhattan. And it was apparently, besides having the CBS news and all the videotape machines on the top and the main floors below, had been a cow barn. And there were these stalls, and they were filled with old CBS equipment. Talk about a museum. This place was just filled with, like, snake pits from Indiana Jones or from with cables going this way and that, or Gunga Din. And then there were microphones the size of pineapples. And you could just see Edward R. Murrow standing on the rooftop in the Blitz and saying, "This is London calling." And standing in front of one of these big monitors. And he said, you know, you can have this stuff, so, but we'll bring it down to you. Because David and Mary Curtis had a loft on the Lower East Side on Rivington Street, and this was not a good neighborhood. There wasn't Tony neighborhood at that point. It was really, you remember that neighborhood very well, I'm sure. And it was poor, and it was near a very heavy drug neighborhood. Well, so they brought this stuff down, and Bob Zagorin was so great. At one point, he had taken off his suit jacket, and he was soldering all this stuff, and he was putting an intercom system together. We need an intercom. How can you do television without an intercom? And there were like 1930s headsets for telephone operators. And they were just these marvelous things that had no relevance to anything we thought we were doing. And then they were talking at one point, maybe not at exactly that same point. And they said, well, wait a minute. Bob Zagorin, I think, came from him, although I wasn't privy. Don can tell us, is you need it to do mobile. You're doing location, right? Well, to do that, you need a truck. A truck. I mean, I was living in my VW bus, and I had a a plywood box, and in the plywood box was all my video equipment. I slept on top of that box. That was what I needed for a truck. Well, it got to be 6 o'clock, and they had to go home to Connecticut. So they left, and out on the street was a bread truck, and it was about the size of a UPS vehicle, you know, and it had nothing on it except it was gray and had a big black eye. Do you remember that truck? Big, and it was the most iconic corporate logo probably ever, the eye. Everybody knew that was CBS. And there it was sitting on the street, and Rivington Street, and the guys who had left it there had gone home and had left us the keys. So he said, let's go for a ride. So the hippies, I can only look at myself in that way. And so we got in the truck. And we went for a ride. We drove down to Rivington Street. I think of Rivington Street. I don't know who was there. This is 44 years ago. I'm going to tell you. I remember specifically David and Mary Curtis and Davidson. And I'm sure that Chuck was there because the van. This was an empty big truck, and the driver's seat was right in the empty space. And it was filled with smoke within seconds. I mean, it was just filled with smoke. So we take a right off of Rivington Street, we go up to Houston Street, and there's a stop sign, and I stop at the stop sign, and there's a cop on the corner. And the cop looks at the truck, and he looks at the hippies, and he says, roll down the window. And then I discover you can't roll down the window in this truck. It's a little bit warm, so I have to open the door and let the smoke out, and the cop is really skeptical. So he says, where did you get the truck? I said, well, we're doing a show for the CBS and the SQN Productions, and it's Don West, and he's Frank Stanton's. The cop is looking at the truck, and he's looking inside, and he's seeing who's there. And he said, you're doing a show for CBS. He said, what's it called? And I said, and this is a problem, because I don't think we knew originally it was subject to change. I think we knew it was the Now Project, and I think we knew it was SQN Productions, but we didn't know, we didn't have the name yet. I didn't came up with the name subject to change. So I'm fumbling over this one, and it's weird. The cop is giving me a look like, this is real trouble. And then the cop says to me, when's it going to be on? I said, oh, we're going to replace the Smothers Brothers. And the cop says, oh, okay, go on. Everybody, Don was right, 50% of the American public had an opinion on whether the Smothers Brothers should go. We thought at that time that it was completely possible. And it seemed that way. We put a man or two men on the moon just a few months before. The Mets were about to win the World Series. And everything seemed possible. It seemed possible that we could do this without ever compromising anything of our own beliefs, without ever having to make any deal with CBS. I think Don's right in that. We thought we were going to change CBS. We just didn't need it. They would just come to us because what we were doing was so self-evidently important and so great and wonderful. And we got a rude awakening when Don West, as you saw Nancy say in the video clip of the film, well, yeah, they told us 5 years. Well, they were kind of right to the year in the sense that that there was something on PBS within 5 years shot with border packs and half-inch tape. But that's a different tale. What Don did was, in the context of his time, completely realistic and completely plausible. It was completely insane in some ways, but he did it, and no one else in broadcasting was willing to do it. And I'm grateful that he gave us the chance to do it.